Hi everyone. So I'm going to continue to talk about vapor pressure a little bit, and then we're going to switch gears and talk about heating curves, which is the way to envision the energy transfer that's needed in order to convert from the solid state to the liquid state to the gas state. Now, the vapor pressure curve that I showed you in the previous video is shown again here. And again, I just want to emphasize the fact that some liquids are what we refer to as volatiles, which means that they exert quite a large vapor pressure even at very low temperature. And some liquids are not as volatile, like water, for example, is not so volatile. But then you have things like ethylene glycol, which is really, really not volatile because it barely has any vapor pressure even at quite high temperature. Now, by the way, the value of pressures, as we discussed before in the gas chapter, is very different depending on depending on altitude. So, at very high altitude, for example, in Mount Whitney in California, your external pressure is only about 0.6 atmosphere because there are fewer gas particles in the atmosphere, so you have a lower atmospheric pressure. And as a result, because if you think about the definition of the normal boiling point as being the point at which, so the normal boiling point, of course, we define this as the temperature at which the vapor pressure of that liquid is equal to 760 torr. But the boiling point in general is just defined as the point at which the vapor pressure of the liquid is equal to the pressure of the atmosphere. So at sea level, this is of course also 760. So in other words, the normal boiling point and the boiling points are equal at sea level. But when you start to move to different altitudes, your boiling point then actually changes because the atmospheric pressure changes. So for example, at at sea level, your boiling point is going to be where the vapor pressure is 1 atmosphere. But at on the top of Mount Whitney, then your boiling point would be the temperature at which your vapor pressure of your liquid will be 0.6 atmosphere. So if you're talking about something like water, if you're looking at water, for example, to be to give you about 0.6 atmosphere, which is around this number right here, you're looking at this number, that's going to be in the 80s, 80 degrees or so is where water will boil. On the top of Mount Whitney, of course, if you look at this number right here, it actually tells you that it's 87 degrees. So you can see that as you go higher and higher altitude, because of the decrease in the external pressure, the atmospheric pressure, your boiling point, the temperature at which water will boil, will also decrease to lower and lower temperature. And that's important because then when we discuss, we always talk about this idea that when you try to cook something, for example, at a higher altitude, you actually don't get, you have to cook that object longer. And the reason being that because there's a certain amount of energy that needs to be provided in order to cook, in other words, to convert, let's say a raw meat to cook meat, for example, or a raw egg to cook egg, you need to put in a certain amount of energy. If that energy at 80 degrees Celsius is just not equal to the amount of energy you get at 100 degrees Celsius, so if you're doing it at 87 degrees Celsius, then that means you have to cook it longer in order to get the same total energy at the end that's equal to that you get from 100 degrees Celsius. Okay, so the next topic I want to talk about here is something referred to as a heating curve. So this is basically a type of plot that you can generate to illustrate how much energy would be needed to convert a substance, a pure substance in this case, from its solid form to its liquid form to its gas form. Okay, and here, this particular drawing here is showing water and the heating plot for water. So let me just talk through about what the components of a heating curve is. You basically have your temperature axis on the y-axis, and you have your usually either energy, heat added in this particular case. So sometimes people also use time, which all corresponds to the amount of energy that you have to add in order to make that conversion from a solid to a liquid, or a liquid at a lower temperature to a liquid at a higher temperature. And there's a couple of things that you need to think about here in terms of a heating curve. And the concept I want to talk about is that you notice that the way this heating curve works is that there's parts of the heating curve where it looks like a diagonal, right? So there's an increase in temperature basically as energy is being added, which is this component right here, and then this component right here. So those are calculations that you need to do that involves an increase in temperature, and this type of calculations you can do using those heat capacity equations that you learn in the thermochemistry chapter. So if you remember those equations, they all have the form of, MC delta T usually, or C delta T, just depends on what information is given to you. Now, as far as then, there's also these parts of the curve that are flat, okay? And so if you think about it, what's that telling you? That's telling you that as energy is being added, the temperature remains the same. So this part of the curve, both of these, corresponds to phase transition curves, which is basically the part of the curve that indicates how much energy is needed to convert that solid to a liquid form. Okay, so when we start here, it's a solid at 0 degrees. This is for ice in this case. When we end here, we have liquid water at 0 degrees. And then if you put in more energy, then the liquid water would start to increase its temperature. Same thing here, when you get 100 degrees, initially it's 100 degrees liquid water. But as you input more and more energy, you keep breaking those hydrogen bonds. Eventually, all the hydrogen bonds are broken and it becomes liquid water, it becomes gaseous water at 100 degrees Celsius. And then if you keep increasing energy, now all of those energy is going to go into the gases themselves and start warming up the gas molecules, making them more higher in kinetic energy. So there's always two components of the heating curve. There's the components that include the phase transition, and there's the component that involves temperature change. Now, for the part that includes phase transition, what you have to do to calculate the amount of energy you need to make this process happens, you basically need to figure out how much substance you have, in other words, the number of moles of the substance you have, and then how much energy is needed per, usually given per mole of that phase transition. So, for example, for something like water, in order to convert it from ice to liquid, you're going to need about 6 kilojoules per mole of water. So, if you have 2 moles of water, then you're going to need about 12 kilojoules of energy. Okay, so what I'm going to do is show you hopefully a fairly simple example of how this works using this example right here, which is draw the heating curve for 1 mole of water at 1 atmosphere and calculate the amount of energy needed for each of these processes. Okay, so I'm going to just go through a couple of the steps here because the concepts of the calculation is actually fairly straightforward. So the idea here is calculate the energy that's needed for all of the different processes here. First, we want to warm up the ice from negative 25 to 0 degrees Celsius, and you're given the specific heat of ice here, which is 2.09 joules per gram degree Celsius, and then you have to calculate all the other components here as well. Okay, so I'm going to start with that one, the warming of ice. And so to solve that particular that first problem, as we talked about before, you just need to use your MC delta T equation. In this particular case, you're given the actual specific heat of ice, so you can multiply this with your mass. Remember that mass here is just number of moles times the molar mass, so that will give me 18 grams, and then the delta T in this case is the delta T from negative 25 to 0, so you take 0 to be your final temperature and negative 25 to be your initial, so 0 minus minus 25 gives you just plus 25, and of course that multiplied together gives you 940.5 joules of energy. Okay, now the second part of the question asks for how much energy is needed to melt, okay, and gives you the delta H of fusion. Now, fusion, if you remember here, is one of the terms that we used before to indicate the conversion of a solid to a liquid. And so you see this term here, fusion. And the term fusion is often used instead of melting because fusion, if you think about it, is really how when you have ice, for example, and it starts to melt, it's sort of like all the ice particles are fusing together, and that's why the term fusion is often used to indicate melting. but it really means the same thing. So in this case, if I want to calculate how much energy I'm going to need to melt 1 mole of water, since I'm already given the delta H of fusion, I just need to multiply this number by 1 mole, which is of course equal to this number again. So then that would be my answer. So as you can see now, if I were to multiply those two numbers together, I'm just going to get 6.02 kilojoules as my answer. Now, you can then proceed with answering all of these questions the same way, with making all those calculations. And what you should be able to get are the following numbers shown here in this slide. You can check the numbers to make sure that you got it correctly. One of the things I want to note right here is, as you can see, the process where you're increasing the temperature actually requires a lot less energy in comparison to the actual process of melting and vaporization itself. So should fix this typo right here. As you can see that for vaporization, you need about 40.7 kilojoules in order to vaporize or convert basically from liquid to vapor the 1 mole of water, whereas for melting, you need about 6 kilojoules, whereas correspondingly to increase the temperature of ice for 25 degrees, you only need less than 1 kilojoule, same thing to increase the temperature of steam by 25 degrees. And in order to increase temperature of liquid water by 100 degrees, you need about, 7.5 kilojoules, which is sort of comparable to melting. So in fact, the process that requires a lot of energy is this phase transition process, and that's something you want to keep in mind when you're making these calculations. So of course, the heating curve itself was the one that we started with, so we talked about it before. So if you're asked to actually plot this heating curve, then you would actually start with a temperature, and then you would start with heat added here, or time, or energy, and then you would just plot it this way. And of course, the length of these plots here had to do with how much energy actually requires, and you can hopefully see that the vaporization is the one that requires the most amount of energy, because that's the longest part of your curve. It contains the most energy here from this point to that point. So the last component of this topic I want to talk about is something referred to as phase diagrams. And that's basically the idea that we can represent how a particular pure substance changes its different states from solids to liquids to gas, using a plot of that substance as a function of pressure and temperature. So your y-axis here is pressure and your x-axis here is temperature. And this particular phase diagram is shown for water. And what it is, this phase diagram, you always have the solid portion of the diagram on the left side. And that makes sense because that's low temperature and high pressure. You imagine that when a substance at low temperature and at very high pressure, it's more likely to be a solid. When that particular substance is at high temperature and low pressure, then it's more likely to be a gas. And of course, something in the middle would be your liquid. So that's the different three portions of your phase diagram. Now, the way you think about this phase diagram is you can navigate around it. And what you do there is you can think about this particular line here is your equilibrium line between your solid and your liquid. So along that particular temperature-pressure combination, both solid and liquid exist at the same time. And this is your, on the other hand, your liquid-gas equilibrium line, in which case at that combination of pressure and temperature, liquid and gas both exist. So of course you can see here at 100 degrees Celsius at 760 torr, we have boiling, which is of course what we see both liquid and vapor water existing at the same time, whereas at 0 degrees Celsius is the solid and the liquid that exists at the same time. A couple of important points. One thing is a part of the phase diagram that's referred to as the triple point, which is basically a pressure-temperature combination that allows all three states of matter to exist at the same time. And then there's also something referred to as supercritical fluid, which is it's marked by this point called a critical point. Basically, beyond this pressure-temperature combination, the liquid and the gas phase sort of mesh together, becoming this uniform phase that it's neither liquid nor solid. And there's certain properties of the supercritical liquid that is unique to it, and it's not present in both the liquid and the gas phase.